Good morning and welcome to this special Sabbath, this Mother's Day Sabbath. My name is Mark Welch and I serve as pastor of Olympia Transformation Life Center, Seventh-day Adventist Church. I want to welcome you to be part of our service this morning. And Olympia Transformation Life Center is a church where we still believe that God is transforming us to be more like Him as we follow Jesus. So I invite you to be part of our worship service today and receive the blessing that God has for you on this special Sabbath.
And we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love Him, who have been called according to His purpose. Romans 8:28.
Before you closed your eyes to sleep, on a journey of your own. May my mistakes not hinder you, but His grace remain and guide you through. This is my prayer for you. This will be my prayer for you. Father, hear my ceaseless prayer. Oh, keep her in your care.
Have a good sleep, okay? Night night, darling.
Night night.
Good morning, church, and happy Sabbath. Hope you guys get a chance to get out there and enjoy the beautiful weather today. It's supposed to be high in the 80s today, so get out there and get a chance to enjoy the weather safely, and maybe go in your backyard, sit there, and have a nice Sabbath out there, and just enjoy God's creation. Today's offering is for World Budget and organizations such as ADRA and such. are really needing some financial support today in light of the current global crisis that we're experiencing. So I just ask that you be faithful and remember your tithes and offerings, and you can mail them to the church. You can give online at the church's website, however is easiest for you. And if you have any questions, check the emails, and Miss Kim Gorton will be glad to help you with arranging any, maybe another method of picking it up or something. So let's open up with a word of prayer and ask God to bless the day today. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for your love. We thank you for your gifts that you've given us today, Father. We need to remember to be thankful, Father, for what we have in right now. If we're alive and breathing, if we have a paycheck, if we have a steady income, if we have a working car, if we have a home, that puts us probably in the top 30% of the global population right now as it stands. We need to remember to be thankful for what we have, Father, and not get so caught up in the crisis and everything going on, Father, but to remember to be thankful for all the blessings you've given us, Father, all the wonderful things we have in our life. I just pray that we just continue to remember that we are loved not only by you, but by each other, Father, and we have each other. We have loved ones around us, Father, and I just pray that you continue to lift us up and help us through this time, Father. And Father, I want to ask a special prayer for those that are suffering with sick and afflicted right now, Father. Those that are suffering the loss of loved ones, Father. I pray that you lift them up, Father, and pick them up this time, Father. I pray that you would strengthen them and give them hope, Father, and just continue to be the source of our strength, Father. And I pray, Father, that while we have all this time, and if we have time on our hands, Father, I pray we would just do a reconnect with you, Father, and reconnect with you and touch out. And I pray that you would, Father, you would touch our hearts in a mighty way, Father. I pray that you would help us use our time to really just dig into your word and have a daily worship just with you, Father. And just I pray that you really touch our hearts and just help us make use of the best use of our time that we have. And I pray that you be with us all today, Father, and be with those that are really hurting right now. And just strengthen us up and be with pastors and give us a sermon today, Father. And I ask that you just bless us all. And we continue to remember you and be thankful for what we have. And ask it through the wonderful name of Jesus Christ, my Savior. Amen. And happy Sabbath.
Praise Him, all creatures here below.
us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for protection for those of us who have fears during this time of current lockdown that we're still in. Please be with all the people who are involved in the front lines of taking care of this pandemic, COVID-19, and how that they sacrifice. Thank you, particularly the ones who work in the emergency rooms and physicians' offices, who put their patients ahead of their own health, maybe in their families. Thank you also, especially for the mothers who care for each and every one of us and provide the love that we need to develop into strong humans. Please be with Mark as he gives his message to us, and be with each and every member as we collectively gather online, a way that we've been used to living now for quite some time. Please help us to benefit from the lesson and the sermon that Pastor Mark has for us today. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Good morning and welcome to Transformation Life Center. We're glad that you've joined us today for a special Sabbath. And it's a special Sabbath because tomorrow is a special day. Of course, every Sabbath is a blessing from God, but tomorrow is a special day on your calendar. So, gentlemen, husbands, fathers, children, these flowers are a reminder something special is happening tomorrow, and it involves your wife, involves your mother. So be thinking about that. And so I thought it would only be fair to invite the mother that I know best to join me this morning as we talk about what it means to be a mother and some of the deep experiences that mothers have in this role that God has given them. So this is my wife, Carrie, and thank you so much for joining me today. We were thinking about mothers in the Bible, and as we were thinking about mothers, we're thinking about a phrase that is common to perhaps mothers everywhere. And Carrie was saying, just as we were talking a few moments ago, that something about being a mother, as soon as you have a child, then guilt is right there. And so we have this phrase, and what was the phrase that we thought of?
If only.
Okay, if only, if only. And you can fill in the blank, especially as a mother. If only, and it could be something that you did or failed to do, or your children, or your husband, or the environment, or anyone in your circle. When you think about that, Carrie, and it was interesting to me because I was thinking about mothers, and I was thinking about mothers who wrestled with difficult things in Bible history. And this phrase came to my mind, and separately it came to Carrie's as well. It's a powerful phrase. But when you thought of this, what was behind that? What was underneath that expression of if only? What are you thinking of?
Well, of course, since I'm a mother and I'm thinking about our children and I'm thinking about our life together, I look in the past and I think about how some things could have been different. And the term if only came to mind because, of course, there are things that have happened to us and to our children that we wish hadn't. We wish had been different. I wish had that God had intervened. Mm-hmm. And so that phrase, if only, seemed so fitting. Yeah.
Is there a particular thing that you think of when you think of that phrase? Is there a particular experience in our life as parents and your life as a mother that you think of?
Well, I think as soon as they had Spencer, or even before I had Spencer, the term if only came to mind, and it has continued periodically through our experiences that we've had, especially the tough times. Mm-hmm.
And for you, that if you're not familiar with our family, Spencer is 21. He's our oldest, and we have three boys and a daughter, and they range from 21 down to 10. So we have quite a spread in age. And we've had some experiences with each one. Mm-hmm. Our oldest son, just a few years ago, had a battle with cancer, and we're very grateful that he's recovered and he's doing well in college now. But you don't forget. We had our next youngest son spent, what was it, a week? How long was Graham in the hospital? Was it a week or?
Yeah, 6 days.
6 days with what was probably salmonella.
Or E. coli.
E. coli, that's what it was. E. coli poisoning, and we didn't, it was very difficult to discover what was wrong. And there's a sense of helplessness, there's a sense of frustration, and there's this question, if only this wouldn't have happened. If only God would have intervened. If only people would have treated us differently. I've had some difficult experiences professionally. As people who are familiar with us and with me know that I wasn't always a pastor. This is a second career for me, and I'm very glad to be a pastor. But I worked in the insurance industry, and I've been let go. I've been fired multiple times. And of course, whenever that happens, or when you have a negative review from your whoever is your supervisor or your person who's responsible for you, I always wonder, if only I would have worked harder, if only I would have done things differently. But we think of people in the Bible, and when you think of someone, Carrie, when you think of women in the Bible who ask that question, who's someone that you're thinking of?
Well, the person that came to mind quickly was Naomi. And to think that she had lost her husband and then lost her two sons, and she was living in a foreign land. And I think she really spoke, she didn't speak if only, but she conveyed that, mm-hmm. what she was saying to Ruth and Orpah.
She had there's several instances where she speaks in the story, and there's a strong sense of her frustration, even bitterness.
Regret,
maybe anger with God. Mm-hmm. If you have your Bibles, and I hope that you do, take your Bibles and turn to the book of Ruth, and let's look at this story and see where we find Ruth and Naomi. Naomi is the first person we see in the story, and then Ruth comes just a little bit later. But Ruth chapter 1, and beginning at verse 1, it sets the stage by saying that this is during the time of the judges. Ruth chapter 1 and verse 1, in the days when the judges ruled in Israel, a severe famine came upon the land. So a man from Bethlehem in Judah left his home and went to live in the country of Moab, taking his wife and two sons with him. The man's name was Elimelech, and his wife was Naomi. Their two sons were Mahlon and Chilion. They were Ephrathites from Bethlehem in the land of Judah. And when they reached Moab, they settled there. So this is the starting of the story. There is, think of it in our terms, there's a restructuring at the company where he works. In his case, their culture is very agricultural. And so when there's a dry year and not enough rain, it has a profound impact on everything in the community, because that's what they're depending on. It's an agrarian society, so if farming doesn't go well, no one is doing well. So let's keep reading. Carrie, why don't you read verse 3, 4, and 5, see what happens here.
Then Elimelech died, and Naomi was left with her two sons. The two sons married Moabite women. One married a woman named Orpah, and the other a woman named Ruth. But after 10 years later, both Mahlon and Chilion died. This left Naomi alone, without her two sons or her husband.
What a shock it must have been for Naomi. Now she's stuck in a foreign country, and her sole means of support are her two daughters-in-law. Now, culture would have dictated that her two daughters, Orpah and Ruth, would support her. And Naomi does something very significant here, and it helps to show some of her character, because you don't always get that in the story. She seems bitter and so disappointed. She should be. She's lost her husband and her two sons. But let's see what she does here. Verse 6, Naomi heard in Moab that the Lord had blessed his people in Judah by giving them good crops again. So the famine is over. She got word that people in the hometown are doing well again. And so she decided that she would leave and go back home. So verse 7 says, with her two daughters-in-law, she set off from the place where she had been living in Moab, and they took the road that would lead them back to Judah. But then Naomi has some second thoughts about what she's doing. And this is where we see a really gracious character, part of her character coming out. Why don't you read that, Carrie? Verse 8 and verse 9.
But on the way, Naomi said to her two daughters-in-law, go back to your mother's homes, and may the Lord reward you for your kindness to your husbands and to me. May the Lord bless you with the security of another marriage. Then she kissed them goodbye, and they all broke down and wept.
So apparently, Ruth and Orpah are still young enough in the culture of that time that they would have been able to go back to their homes of origin and find another husband and remarry and establish a home, and you can start over again. Now, how do these two daughters-in-law respond? And it says a great deal about how Naomi must have treated them when they came to live with her. Let's read that in verse 10.
No, they said, we want to go with you to your people. But Naomi replied, why should you go on with me? Can I still give birth to other sons who could grow up to be your husbands? No, my daughters, return to your parents' homes, for I am too old to marry again. And even if it were possible and I were to get married tonight and bear sons, then what? Would you wait for them to grow up and refuse to marry someone else? No, of course not, my daughters. Things are far more bitter for me than for you, because the Lord himself has raised his fist against me.
Wow. That's really strong. It's really strong language. So you can hear Naomi saying, if only. And I thought of some things that Naomi might have been saying as she's thinking about how bitter her life is. If only. If only there wasn't a famine. If only we hadn't left Bethlehem, if we'd stayed there. If only my husband would have remained healthy and he would not have died. If only my two sons would have thrived in Moab. And perhaps maybe the final one, if only I would have had some grandchildren. When you think about these, Carrie, which of these do you think might have resonated? I mean, as a man and reading the story, I'm thinking these might have been some of the if onlys in her mind. What jumps out to you?
Oh, well, losing her husband and her sons, not knowing what the future will hold for her, mm-hmm. Being all alone. I mean, it sounds like what I read in the Bible, what we just read, is she has quite a relationship with Ruth and Orpah. For them to weep and want to stay with her,
yeah,
that speaks volumes to me. And not only had she lost her husband, she was going to lose, she lost her two sons, and then she was going to lose her two daughter-in-laws. That right. She was calling them daughters. She wasn't saying daughter-in-laws. She was saying daughters, and so they meant a great deal to her, and she meant a great deal to them. So she just was having one loss after another, and the question, or well, it's not a question, a statement, if only, I mean, she just has so many setbacks, you know, the drought, she had to leave her hometown, she went with her husband, trusting him. And then he died, then she had her boys to finish raising, and then they married, and things were looking promising, and then they died, and what devastation.
Yeah. And you see that in the last thing that she says there, which is really powerful. We're reading out of the New Living Translation, and I like the graphic way that the translators share the language with us. It says in verse 13, it says that the last part of verse 13 says, "Things are far more bitter for me than for you." This is Naomi speaking to her two daughters-in-law, Ruth and Orpah, "because the Lord himself," the Lord himself, "has raised his fist against me."
Do you remember when you're talking last night, I think it was, the "if only" may seem directed to circumstances or to people, but ultimately, for me, I can't speak for you, but it actually is towards God. Mm-hmm. And there's anger involved. Mm-hmm. "Lord, if only you had helped Mark find a job at this point, or even if helped him keep this job," because some of those jobs that you had lost were not your doing. And
yeah.
You said multiple. That's not true. It just feels like it.
Yeah.
But, you know, just even from the beginning of our marriage, we have so many if onlys. And that's how I viewed it. If only. And then, as more I dwelled on that question or statement, I keep wanting to say the question, it really went back to God.
Mm-hmm.
Why did he allow that to happen?
Yeah. And I think it's really powerful that what you're saying here, Carrie, because, you know, sometimes, friends, when we think of a question like this, like if only, sometimes we can ask the question and let that kind of marinate in our minds without recognizing and acknowledging what is behind that. Mm-hmm. And
Naomi didn't. She just came out and said, "because the Lord himself has raised his fist against me." Pretty direct.
Well, isn't that interesting? Yeah. That she was clear about, mm-hmm. She had a sense of bitterness. And look at this. If we were to keep reading here, we're just going to skip ahead. We'll come back to the beautiful statements of Ruth and Orpah. But when she arrives in Bethlehem, the people say, "oh, look, Naomi is back." And what does she say? This is verse 20. Go ahead, Carrie. Why don't you read verse 20?
"No, don't call me Naomi," she responded. "Instead, call me Mara. For the Almighty has made life very bitter for me. I went away full, but the Lord has brought me home empty. Why call me Naomi when the Lord has caused me to suffer and the Almighty has sent such tragedy upon me?"
You may notice, if you look in the notes in your Bible, Naomi means pleasant, but Mara means bitter. So Naomi says, "don't even call me by that name anymore. It doesn't fit. That's not my life anymore. I have a bitter life. And that's, you can just call me something else right now, because God has done this to me." And now, granted, back in their time, they saw God doing many things, and that it was very, their lives were very literal, in the sense that if something bad happened, they believed that God had done that to them. But I wonder if it would be worthwhile for us, and you think about your own experience, when you ask that question, or when you think to yourself, "if only this would not have happened, what am I really saying? Who's really to blame underneath that?" There's another question I think that's worth considering. And this one I have to give credit where credit is due, because Carrie came up with this question a number of years ago, and I think it's really excellent. So I'm going to share it with you. And I don't know where you got this. It's really wise. The question is, do you remember this one?
I don't even remember. I'm bracing myself. What are you going to say?
It's the thing that you always say is, where is it taking you?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. I don't know where you got that, but it's really powerful. So friends, just think about that. When I ask the question, if only, and when I'm marinating in that bitterness, that regret, that wishing that I could relive or change the past, where is that taking me? And where is it taking you? So how do we turn the corner from this statement of regret and wishing things were different? If only. How do we answer that implied question, that longing that life would have been different back when? If only things were different, if only. How do we answer that?
Well, as we were talking the other night, I think what we came up with, or what we thought, we really have to make a conscious choice that we're going to believe that God is in control and that He's going to lead us through whatever we're facing, and He's going to take care of us in the best.
In the way that He can.
That's right.
In the way that He can. It's kind of a Romans 8:28, believing that God really is going to work all things together for good.
We may not like what we're going through at that moment, but if we know that God's going to get us to the other side of that problem or situation, or help us deal with the past even.
Right. But it requires a choice. Mm-hmm. It requires a choice.
Daily. Because not only we think that, oh, that's in the past, but Satan does a very good job of bringing the past back to haunt us.
He does.
And that's where guilt comes in, bitterness and resentment. Mm-hmm. And we have to choose daily to give that over to God. And we have to choose daily to have that faith and that trust that only He can provide, or He can demonstrate in our lives.
Yeah. There's a memory verse we've learned in our family. It's Joshua 24:15. It's just a few books before the book of Ruth. Let's turn there and just look at this challenge that Joshua made to the people of his day. This is his closing statement, if you will, at the end of his leadership, of his ministry as a leader. He's led the people into the promised land, but now he's at the end of his life and leadership, and he has a closing statement to all of God's people. And he says this in Joshua 24 and verse 15. Joshua 24:15. He says, there are lots of people, not people, there are lots of deities, of gods, supernatural beings. There are lots of entities that you could serve. If you choose not to serve God, you have other choices. And I think that as people, we don't think of ourselves today as serving other gods. But when we ask the question, if only, we're serving gods of regret, of bitterness, of resentment, wouldn't you say?
Mm-hmm.
Good. but really, we're serving another god. And notice what Joshua says here in verse 15, if you refuse to serve the Lord, then choose today whom you will serve. Would you prefer the gods your ancestors served beyond the Euphrates? Or will it be the gods of the Amorites in whose land you now live? And when you think back to your past experience, or mine or yours, and we think of our families of origin and the question, the if only in their life and who they were serving, friends, we have a choice. What's going to occupy our minds and our thinking? And Joshua challenges the people of his day. He says, will it be all of those gods? But as for me and my family, we will serve the Lord. So we have a choice to make. So we turn back to the book of Ruth, and let's see how Ruth demonstrates in a powerful way. It's really amazing. Mm-hmm. Here she is, the daughter-in-law, and she demonstrates this triumph over circumstance, over disaster, over death itself. Let's pick up the story. Naomi has told her two daughters-in-law to find their own way home, to go home and start a new family. And she has, and really this is a very magnanimous, it's a gracious thing that Naomi is doing. She's releasing them to start a new life. But how do they respond?
Well, they said no, they wanted to stay with her.
Yeah. And she tried to convince mm-hmm. them. They wept together. We finished just a few moments ago reading Ruth chapter 1 and verse 14, how they wept together. Notice it says, but Ruth clung tightly to Naomi. She had an extra level of emotional bonding in a positive sense with her mother-in-law. Verse 15, Naomi said to Ruth, your sister-in-law has gone back to her people and to her gods. You should do the same. So this is a conversation that's happening over a period of time, whether it was minutes or how long it took. But Naomi convinced Orpah to go back home. And so Orpah takes her things and her little bundle of whatever she had and heads back to her family. But Ruth says no, and let's read her words. These are beautiful words, often quoted at weddings, but they really don't apply to weddings. Notice the context here. This young woman, Ruth, is speaking this to her mother-in-law. Verse 16.
But Ruth replied, don't ask me to leave you and turn back. Wherever you go, I will go. Wherever you live, I will live. Your people will be my people, and your God will be my God. Wherever you die, I will die, and there I will be buried. May the Lord punish me severely if I allow anything but death to separate us.
And then it says in verse 18 that when Naomi saw that Ruth was determined to go with her, she said nothing more. So Ruth had the last word, but unlike some of our conversations when we have the last word, I know I have the last word, it's not kind, but what a statement of loyalty and devotion. So what is Ruth choosing here? What is she choosing? Because it's easy for us to look at this story and say, well, that was thoughtful of Ruth. That's so kind of her. But we skip over the significance of what she's choosing. When you think about her choice as a daughter-in-law, what stands out in your mind that she's choosing now?
Well, that she's choosing to stay with Naomi, to leave her country, her own country, her own people. She's choosing to go with Naomi to a foreign land. Yeah. She has no promise of a future. She has, all she's clinging to is Naomi.
Yeah. And Naomi can't really offer anything to her. She's already said so. So her future will be as a servant, as a working servant to provide for Naomi, because Naomi is older. She's not going to be able to work and earn much of a living. So Ruth knows she's going to go with Naomi and she'll be the one providing. So she's leaving the prospect of having a new home, a new husband, a family. And she's persisting in this greater loyalty to her mother-in-law and her mother-in-law's people, to a new culture, a new hometown.
But you have to think that God is playing a part in this. And she's had the exposure of God in her life. So she sounds like she's very open to Naomi's way of life and her culture, and she wants to, sounds like, have more of that experience. And but like you said, she's choosing to do that over what she's known mm-hmm. to the unknown.
She really is, and isn't it powerful? Just as Naomi is open about her if only statement, and she takes that back, straight back to God. If we were to think, what is behind Ruth's choice, and we're talking about what she's leaving behind and where she's going, And as you're pointing out, there must have been a tremendous bond between them. And the story here in the book of Ruth doesn't tell us so much about how Naomi won over Ruth's confidence and how she was treated during the time she was her daughter-in-law. The book doesn't tell us that, but there's this tremendous sense of love and affection and devotion between these two women. But where is, so we see that those are some of the things that evidently were behind her statement of this choice. Where is this statement, I'm choosing you, Naomi, I'm choosing your people, your family, your culture, I'm choosing your God? Where is that taking her?
Well, I think it's taking her to a greater faith in God, and that's ultimately what God wants for her and for each one of us.
It's powerful, isn't it? Because we know the rest of the story, you know, and we know how God ultimately works all things together for good. And not only does she get a new husband and a new family and a son, and she's connected into the genealogy of she's the great-great-grandmother of King David, but she's also included in the genealogy of Jesus himself.
But she didn't know any of that. When she chose to go with Naomi, she just made one choice. And then she took that, and then she went with Naomi, and she made another choice. And then she just continued to make one choice after another in faith. And she didn't know the end from the beginning, but she chose to believe, and she put her trust in God. Yeah. And that's really powerful.
Yeah. How does that impact you when you think about this story in your own experience as a mother? What does that say to you? Ruth's choice to choose to trust God now, not knowing what the future is going to bring.
Well, you know, looking back of our children's, you know, the birth of our children, the situations our children have been in, the situations we've been in with our children, the heartbreak we've experienced, the challenges we've experienced. Not too many years ago, actually, I realized I had a choice to make. I could either regret and feel guilty and struggle with bitterness, or I could make a choice, and I choose to believe all things work together for good. And I can believe in God, that He is supreme, and that even though bad things happen, that He still loves me, He still loves my children, He still loves you. And I have to make that choice every single day. Yeah. And some days I have to make it almost every single hour, because it seems like Satan is bombarding me with guilt and resentment and frustration and irritation.
Yeah. It's powerful, isn't it?
Yes, it is. You know, God gave us that gift of choice, and I need to use it.
Yeah. Mrs. White says in Steps to Christ that everything depends on the right action of the will. And we can't make ourselves better people. We can't make ourselves behave as we ought to. And we can't make ourselves more acceptable and attractive to God. But we can choose to be His. And we can choose to trust Him, even when we don't feel it, especially when we don't feel that way. Together, we want to appeal to you. We're still working out our own faith with fear and trembling, as the Bible says. But where are you in this story? On this Mother's Day, especially ladies, and whether you are a biological mom or whether you are in a mothering relationship with children, It doesn't matter. You still have the if only still crowds into your thinking. Don't you think?
Oh, yes.
Yeah. Anytime you're involved with kids, if only is always there. If only they wouldn't have jumped off the swing set. You know, if only they weren't on their devices so much. I mean, if only they would practice their piano lesson. You know, if only, I mean, just on and on. If only they would have studied for their chemistry test, whatever it is. So as parents, and especially as moms, it's so easy for us to go down that road. But it's worthwhile to ask ourselves, what's behind that question, number one? And number two, where's that question taking me? Is it taking me to more trust and confidence in God, or more bitterness and resentment? And I think that you'll find, as we're continuing to find, that a choice to trust God is a powerful antidote. It's a powerful way to answer, if only.
And I want to add too that as mothers, we have to think about what kind of legacy do we want to give our children? Do we want to demonstrate to our children? They're going to hear the resentment, the bitterness, the anger. You may not say it. I'm angry with God, or I'm angry with my husband, but our children can sense it.
Yeah.
Is that the kind of legacy that I want to give my children, that my children will remember me by? Or do we want to leave the legacy of, even though life was hard,
yeah,
I still will trust in God, and I still will have faith in Him, and I will still walk daily with Him? That's the legacy I want to leave with my children. I want to give them every single day.
Yeah. And that's a choice that you can make. And the good news, friends, is that no one, not even the archenemy himself, can take that choice away from you. And maybe that's why Joshua said, choose today whom you're going to serve. The gods of your past, of the disappointment and failure and bitterness you've experienced, or are you going to serve the Lord who promises you a bright future? The one who said, I can work all things together for good. So we want to invite you, friends, to choose to trust Jesus and let the if only take care of itself, to make that choice. And God really will work it out on Mother's Day and on every day.
Thank you. child.